Good morning. Welcome to Lakeville United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Ed, and I am so glad to see you all here with us today. Before we begin, we do have just a few announcements to bring before the congregation. Tonight at 6 p.m. is our family Christmas night. So please come have a great and wonderful time. We're going to hear some wonderful music, sing some carols, have a great meal, bring a dish to pass, and I hear for the kids, there might be a special visitor from the North Pole. So, 6 o'clock, here tonight, our family Christmas night. Invite everyone you know. Invite your friends, invite your neighbors, invite the person you see, admire everyone. The sewing group is collecting items for Newton Park Christmas raffle. The basket's theme is Baby Jesus, and it's planned for a small boy. So please bring basket items to the church conference room by Thursday, December 8th. And we're looking for items that will be suitable for a small boy. Lions Club Blitz Day for Toys for Tots is at Lakeville United Methodist Church this Saturday, December 10th. Drop off food and toy donations at a.m. to noon. Volunteer to help. If we want to help, you talk to Larry. We talked to Larry. The annual giving tree. I hope you saw it when you entered into the church today. We already have quite a few presents under there, but we need more. So bring in the annual giving tree gifts. Collect one of the ornaments. Buy a gift for the age group. Bring it in, place it under the tree, and we'll be delivering those next Sunday. Correct? Judy? Yeah, the 11th. Next Sunday. I had to do the math real fast. So bring it in by next Sunday, and we'll deliver them to the YWCA and help some really wonderful kids. Recycle your used bed sheets to the sewing group to make bandages. Drop them off in the box in the entryway. And that's all we have up here. Do you all have any announcements you'd like to make and bring before the congregation? Well, if not, then I invite you to rise your able in body and spirit for our opening prayer. Lord God, in the hustle and bustle of the holiday season, from the busyness of our lives, we take a moment to come here, gather together and be with you, God. Lord, today we pray that we can receive your hope, an everlasting hope, a true hope, so we can leave here hope-filled people, ready to do the work you've called us to do, to help others receive the joy, peace, love, and hope that you have for us. Lord, guide us in worship today, and we pray for your Holy Spirit to be here amongst us, so the words from our mouths will bring praise to your holy name. And it's in that holy name we pray this day. Amen. I invite you to remain standing to turn to your hymnals, number 216, Lo, how a rose e'er blooming. Turn. Oh, hey! From tender stem, I invite you to remain standing for our call to worship.
In this season of prophecy, promise, and preparation, we come to be renewed and refreshed.
We come to be inspired by stories of the Messiah who will change the world and change us.
We come to listen for words of hope and joy, promise and challenge.
We come with open ears, open minds, and open hearts. We come to receive the blessings God has in store for us in this season of waiting.
Come, let us worship our God, the one who brings all things to fulfillment.
You may be seated.
Good morning. Today's Advent reading comes from Isaiah 60, 2 through 3. For darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples, but the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will appear over you. Nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. We light this candle as a symbol of Christ our hope. May the light sent from God shine in the darkness to show us the way of salvation. O come, Emmanuel.
At this time, I invite the kids to come forward for Stump the Pastor. Yeah, you did. Okay. Okay. It's for me? Here, hold it, and maybe it'll be your item to stump me with, okay? Because maybe they didn't bring anything either. Did you guys bring anything to stump me? Okay. So we have two kids with something to stump me with. So, let's see, who can be a judge today? Carolyn Ort, could you raise your hand? Okay, Ricky, Alyssa, could you go talk to Miss Carolyn back there, and she's gonna judge which one you guys are gonna stump me with? How are you all doing? Good? You guys excited for Christmas? Ricky just got a little excited. So what do you guys want for Christmas?
What do you want?
Hmm. That sounds like a great gift. Okay. All right. Who has the item to stump me with? Okay. I know what these are.
What?
They're Ewoks.
Yep.
Okay.
There's a window for our parents are mad.
Yeah? Mm-hmm. Okay, so for the audience to see this, these are Ewoks. Have you seen Return of the Jedi?
Not yet.
Not
watch Star Wars.
You don't watch Star Wars that much. Who here has seen Return of the Jedi?
My dad has.
Your dad has. Yeah. Okay. Well, in Return of the Jedi, the Empire goes to the forest moon of Endor, and they are going to defeat the rebellion. And the rebels go there to try to destroy the shield generator so they can destroy the second Death Star. This is the kind of person I am, everyone.
I'm with
Good. Yeah. And while there, the rebels, the good guys, meet some unlikely friends, the Ewoks. They're only about 3 feet tall, and they look like giant teddy bears.
That's lower than me.
Yeah. They don't sound very strong, do they?
They look strong.
They look pretty muscular in this. But let's say you saw a 3 foot soft, cuddly teddy bear. Would you be like, ah, yeah, he's a strong guy? You'd go hug it, yeah.
I'd go hug it and sleep with it and roll on it.
Right. So the Ewoks face down the Empire.
I would just leap on it.
Yeah. So these teddy bears go and face the Empire, the strongest force in the galaxy. And they win.
Who is the Empire?
The Empire, well, it was founded by Darth Bad Guys. Stormtroopers, Darth Vader.
Darth Vader's a bad guy?
Spoilers. The answer is sorta. But they face the Empire and they win. And this reminds me of a Bible story you probably all know. Have you ever heard of David and Goliath?
Yeah.
Yeah. David was just a little kid, and he went and fought a giant warrior named Goliath. David had just a sling, just a piece of leather that you put a rock in and you twirl it around. Yeah, you have the little God book of that. Yeah, and Goliath had all this armor, and he had these swords and spears and shields. And David went up and he fought Goliath, and he prayed to God for help and prayed for God for guidance. And you know what happened? David won. Because when God is on our side, we can do anything, right?
Right?
Yeah, thank you, Ricky. Kit Kats are actually my favorite candy bar. So,
well, we have a whole bag.
You have a whole bag?
Yeah, we
have
bought
a white and black one too.
Okay, so when God is on our side, we can do anything. Just like, well, we can do some wonderful things. We can help people. We can grow with God's kingdom. Nothing can stop us. No matter how big the problem we face, with God on our side, nothing is impossible. Just like how the Ewoks, small cuddly teddy bears, could defeat the Empire, we can defeat whatever problem we face. So that's what I think of when I think of Ewoks. Now I have to go home and watch all the Star Wars movies. So, stand up with me. Those who think I was stumped by a pair of Ewoks, like an AT-ST stuck on indoor, raise your hand. Those who think I was unstumped. Okay, this week they were impressed by my Star Wars knowledge. So, have a sit back down real fast, guys. Today, we're going to be talking about a lady who's very important to our nativity scene up there. You know who she is?
Mary.
Today, we are talking about Mary. Mary was a really brave person. God came to her and said, "Hey, Mary, I would like you to bear a kid named Jesus, and Jesus will be God the Son, and Jesus will save everyone."
That's what we read about last night.
Yeah, you read about that last night, yeah. In the Bible. And what did Mary say when God came to her and asked her that? Did she say no?
No.
No, she said, "Yes, I want to be... I will go wherever you ask me to. I'll be a faithful servant. And because she was brave, and she did something that was very impossible, she gave birth to Jesus, who grew up and saved us all. Isn't that amazing? Mm-hmm. So today, we up here in Big Church are going to be talking about Mary. So we got to put her up on the nativity scene. I was wondering if you would help Monroe place Mary up there at the nativity scene, okay? It's right up there.
Pastor,
yeah.
I actually wanted to stump you with myself.
You wanted to stump me with yourself? Okay. Think about that next time, okay? Hey, high five. Gosh. Yeah.
I was like, I don't think you can stump me with yourself because God and Jesus made everybody.
Ooh, that's a good one. Next time when I'm stumped, I'll ask you to help, okay? Okay. Let's pray, shall we? Let's bow our heads, close our eyes. God, thank you. Thank you for the gift that is Jesus. And Lord, we're so excited that Christmas is just a few weeks away. Prepare us to receive that wonderful gift in Jesus. And God, let us remember that no matter what problems we're facing, with you on our side, all things are possible. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, go back to Miss Judy, and she'll take you to Kids Church, okay? At this time, I invite the ushers to come forward to collect our tithes and our offerings.
Thank you.
Lord God, we recognize all that we have as a gift from you. In gratitude, we return these, our first fruits, our tithes, and our offerings. We lay them at your feet, God, and we pray for a blessing be upon them, so they may help us continue to do the missions and ministries you've entrusted to our care, so that we can go out and spread the good news, not just to our community, but to all, to help them discover the hope we have in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated. Wait a second. There we go. As we enter into this time of prayer, I do invite you to lift up before God and before the congregation names for us to pray over this week, and also God sightings, so that we as a church family can celebrate all that the Lord has done for us together. And if you're viewing us from home, we invite you to post on our Facebook wall or YouTube feed any prayer requests you may have. And if during the week you have a prayer request or a prayer concern, I invite you to call myself or the church office, and we'll put your name on the prayer board and make sure they are prayed over. At this time, I invite you to lift up names in prayer. Yeah, Martha.
My sister Jan Brown had a shoulder replacement this week, and my brother Bill, who's her caregiver, so he probably needs more prayers than her.
Prayers for Jan Brown, who had a shoulder replacement surgery this week. And prayers for Bill as he's taking care of her.
Brenda Caves, sister to me with cancer.
Prayers for Brenda Caves?
Correct.
Who has cancer?
I have a prayer of thanksgiving for a brand new grandson born Friday.
Oh, what's your grandson's name?
Calvin.
Prayers of praise for Calvin. Prayers for Terry Kelly, who's having some health concerns.
Yeah. Continue prayers for Bob and Karen Lind.
I have two praises. One, that we have a dedicated piano player here in our church, and provides us with lovely music every week. And that Denny made it through surgery without complications.
Two praises. One, that we have Kathy with us to bring us such wonderful music. Thank you, Kathy. And also praise that Denny went through his surgery okay, and he's here with us today. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, prepare our hearts this Advent season so we can receive the greatest gift of all, the coming of the Prince of Peace. The Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, God with us, the reason for our hope. Lord, prepare our hearts, and Lord, we pray. We pray for our church. We pray that we can go out and share that gift you've given us with our neighbors, not just in words, but with deeds. Showing our neighbors what it looks like to be a Christ follower.
following the example that God the Son gave us. Lord, we pray for each other. We pray for healing be upon our brothers and sisters, and we pray for your strength, your courage, your guidance. As the end of 2022 draws near and the beginning of 2023, Lord, we pray for guidance into the new year, to see where you're leading us as a church, leading us in new missions, new ministries. Lord, we pray for our community, for our neighbors, our families, and our friends. Lord, we pray for those who are struggling to keep the heat on. We're praying for those that during this time of joy, oh God, they are in the valley of the shadow of sadness and grief, mourning the loss of loved ones, mourning the loss of normal. Lord, be with our neighbors. And Lord, we pray we can be there with them as well. And Lord, we pray for good things for our community. We pray, Lord, also for our nation, our world, and all of the world's leaders. We pray, God, we pray for your wisdom upon our leaders so that your hope, your peace, your love, your joy can wash away the cynicism, the injustice, the hate, and that your kingdom can grow here on earth. And Lord, we give you thanks today. We give you thanks for the roof of our heads. We give you thanks for the beauty of creation. We give you thanks for healing. We give you thanks for good news. We give you thanks for each other. We give you thanks for the holiday season. But most of all, God, we give you thanks for your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who came to be with us, was born and laid in a manger, who grew up, who showed us what it means to be a God follower, who died on a cross and left the tomb empty so the power of sin and death would be defeated forevermore. Lord, it's in his name we now pray the prayer your Son, the Prince of Peace, taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
As you're able, would you stand for the scripture reading? It's taken from Luke, chapter 1, verses 39 through 56. In those days, Mary set out, and went with haste to Judea town in the hill country, where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. It's that season. We'll get there. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leaped in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why has this happened to me, that the mother of my Lord comes to me? For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord." And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowly state of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. Indeed, his mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has come to the aid of his child Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever." And Mary remained with her about 3 months and then returned to her home. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
May the Holy Spirit produce joy in our hearts like it did Mary.
You may be seated. We're continuing our look today about what it means to have an almost Christmas, and how we as people of faith are called to have an altogether complete, true Christmas. Last week, we were talking about what it means to having true peace instead of an almost peace. Almost peace is just momentary. It's aimed inward. And in the end, only true peace comes from Jesus Christ. Do invite you after service today, around 10:30-ish, meet us in the conference room where we'll continue our Bible study of almost Christmas. Today we lit the second candle, the candle of hope.
Two candles down, two left. I hope you have your shopping done. I hope you're excited as I am. I hope. That's usually how we use it these days, isn't it? I hope you have a nice day. I hope my flash drive isn't broken. I hope I save my sermon somewhere else, maybe on my computer. I hope an hour is enough time to rewrite my sermon. I hope. We turn hope into a synonym for the word wish. Around the world, kids are writing lists, hoping that Santa will soon be on his way, wishing for their presents to be under their tree. We hope you have a Merry Christmas. We wish you have a Merry Christmas. They sound about the same, don't they? They both express the idea of something is out of our control, but we'd like it to happen. Yet to us people of faith, hope shouldn't just mean wish. It should mean something so much more. Because hope is foundational to having faith. Hope is foundational to what it means to be a person of faith. Because after all, what does faith actually mean? Well, the best definition we have is from the book of Hebrews. It gives us a wonderful definition. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the convictions of things not seen. To have faith is to have hope, and to have hope is to have faith. You can't have one without the other. That's why we find hope throughout Scripture. Maybe it won't be mentioned by word. They do a lot in the epistles, though. But hope is a common theme. Whether it's the hope the Israelites have of the promised land, if it's the hope the early church has in Jesus Christ, time and time again in Scripture, we are told, be people of hope. It may strike you as odd, though, that I chose this reading today. You might be, well, why, Pastor Ed? Why did you choose the reading of Mary visiting Elizabeth today? Is it because that's what the Advent study told you to do? Well, maybe. But also because, in my mind, when I read this song of Mary, I see it as being hope-filled. It's one of the most hope-filled songs in all of Scripture. Just think about Mary. Just think about what Mary is going through. She is pregnant out of wedlock in a time and place where that could be a death sentence. Yes, she knows she is bearing the Son of God. But do you think her neighbors believed her? At best, they probably just talked about her behind her back. The gossip mill running wild. At worst, they were probably already grabbing the stones. Her life is pretty much in shambles. Plus, who knows what's going to happen to her coming marriage. Joseph has every right to press charges against her. Call off the marriage, send her away, or worse. Yes, we know what happens. We know that God sends an angel to Joseph. But Mary doesn't. Not yet. At this point, it's all up in the air. So she goes to her relative, Elizabeth's, to get away from it all. Get away from the gossip. Get away from the judgment. She goes. She's probably not very hope-filled at the moment. She's probably filled with a lot of doubt, a lot of worry. Some concern, but she walks in, talks to Elizabeth, and she is assured, and she is given hope. She's so moved by this assurance, by this hope, she sings what's called Magnificat, a A prayer of thanksgiving that God has lifted up the lowly. A prayer of thanksgiving for the hope that God brings. A hope that God's justice and will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That the low will be lifted up. That the hungry will be filled. That the last will be first. Hope that no matter what the world looks like, God, love, wins in the end. In my mind, Mary is a truly magnificent example of what it looks like to be a hope-filled person. What it looks like to truly have hope in one's life. She had a complete hope. So friends, do you have a complete hope like Mary, or do we have an almost hope? What does your hope look like? To me, it seems like true hope is rather rare these days. We live in a world that has declared that cynicism and pessimism is wisdom. Watch the news. Read online. Just talk to people. Time and time again, people express the most dour, pessimistic outcomes for the future. Whether it's the war going on in Europe, the economy, or the pandemic, we are taught by the world that hope is foolishness. That this is as good as it gets. It's all downhill from here. That's the world we live in. Nothing will change that. It will only get worse. Just keep your head down. Keep putting one foot in front of the other. Accept it as it is. Worry about yourself. Be cynical. Be pessimistic. Don't be hopeful, because that's just foolishness, and something will pull the rug out from under you. The best you can hope for is that things will go well for you. Hope, wish that you'll win the lottery. Hope, wish that you get that raise or that new position. Hope that you and yours will be just fine. Friends, that isn't true hope. That's a wish. That's, my friends, is almost hope. Almost hope looks a lot like almost peace. It looks inward. Almost hope wants what's best for you. It rejects looking outward, because outward is scary. Outward, things seem to just be getting worse. It's scary and foolish to hope for big things. Instead, be cynical. Be sarcastic. Cynicism is nice and safe and easy. The problem with almost hope is it forgets that a major part of being hopeful is to trust. A key component to hope is trust. We're called to trust that no matter what, in the end, God does win. Love wins. Justice wins. It means that despite all, you trust that God is with you always, and God will help you face the big problems, whether it is injustice, the empire. God will be there with you. God's love will see you through, and you will be rest assured of your salvation. To be people of faith, we need to be people filled with hope. Filled with trust in God, filled with assurance. But pessimism and cynicism is so easy. So easy to fall into that trap. That's why I love what Mary did here. She's probably stressed out and worried. She's probably upset. So what does she do? Does she hole up by herself and doom scroll the internet for hours on end? No, she goes and sees Elizabeth, her family and her friend, who reassures her and is present with her.
Elizabeth just doesn't say something hollow like it's going to be all right. Elizabeth is with her for the long haul. Elizabeth is with her for 3 months. I love that example, friends, and I think it's one we need to follow. It's easy to get pessimistic. I know I do. To get trapped in that trap of cynicism. We need God to see us through, and we need each other. We need each other to be a source of assurance and hope. To help us trust in God's love, not with flippant and hollow platitudes. Because friends, I'll let you know, telling someone not to worry and not to stress never has actually made anyone not worry and stress. Just try that sometimes. It doesn't work. But instead, be a source of hope and trust with your presence and example. Let us show each other what it looks like to be a hope-filled person who trusts in the Lord, and let us be there for the long haul, walking with each other. Not looking to the future with pessimism, but looking with hope and understanding that the present, we are in it together, and we are people of faith together when we walk with each other. But there's one more aspect of true hope we cannot overlook. True hope isn't inward focused. True hope is kingdom focused. True hope looks to where God's will is leading us. True hope calls for God's will to be done. Just look at Mary's prayer once again. The hope she expresses in her prayer isn't aimed inward. It isn't aimed inward. It isn't just wishing for the best for herself or her future kid. No, it looks outward. It's about hope for the world. She hopes the world experiences justice. She hopes the best for her neighbors. She sings out to God and expresses hope that no matter what, God will make things right in the end, that the long arc of history is bent towards justice and love and God. She sings out not just for her, not just for us. She sings out for hope for the world. And friends, the world needs hope. We know this. You've seen it on the news. You've seen it online. You've talked with your friends. The world needs the hope that God brings, the assurance that Christ has given us. The world needs hope. There's one more trap about almost hope, though, I hope you don't fall into. Almost hope leads to idleness. Because after all, if you make a wish to a genie, do you do anything? No, the genie just snaps his fingers, and next thing you know, you're Prince Ali, Alibaba. No, friends, we have hope. We have true hope, and true hope means you're part of the kingdom, and true hope means you have work to do. True hope isn't a wish. It's what gives us assurance and strength and hope to go out and do what we're called to do. Be who we're meant to be. Let everyone know the love of God and the hope we have, the hope that came on Christmas morn, so long ago. Let everyone receive the blessed assurance and eternal love that we know. That we're called to go and make disciples and spread the faith. And friends, that means we spread hope as well in a world of darkness. A darkness filled with cynicism, pessimism. Let us be rays of light filled with hope, pointing back towards God, pointing back to the Prince of Peace. Friends, Mary had hope. Mary had a true hope in God's love. She gave birth to the hope for all the world. Let's follow her examples, always. Peace and hope. True peace, true hope. 2 candles down. Two more to go. Two more to go before we light the Christ candle. Friends, I hope you are ready and excited as I am. Ready and filled with the hope of God, the peace of God. So let's go forth from here to this day, filled with the hope. Filled with the hope and ready to share that hope with all. Amen. Friends, as we enter this time of Holy Communion, I invite you to look up on the screen or turn your Bibles and your hymnals to page 13 for the responses. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, we admit we've made mistakes, that we've not been perfect, that we have fallen short. We've not loved you with our whole hearts, and we've not loved our neighbors as ourselves. That we have sinned, God. And Lord, we pray for your forgiveness. We pray for your grace and your mercy. And Lord, we rest assured in our salvation. The hope born so long ago, the hope laid in a manger, the hope that empowers us to go forth and share your love. Friends, hear the good news. Christ died for us while we are yet sinners. That proves God's love for each and every one of us. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets, who looked for that day when justice shall roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream, when nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, singing, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent in the fullness of time, to be a light to the nations. You scatter the proud in the imagination of their hearts and have mercy on those who fear you from generation to generation. You put down the mighty from their thrones and exalt those of low degree. You filled the hungry with good things and the rich you send empty away. Your own Son came among us as a servant to be Emmanuel. Your presence with us. He humbled himself in obedience to your will and freely accepted death on a cross and resurrection from the tomb. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church and delivered us from slavery to sin and death and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On night which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to the disciples, and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you.
do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, drink from this, all of you. This is the covenant. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, now on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one. The cup over which you give thanks is the sharing in the blood of Christ. At this time, I invite the communion servant to please come forward. Friends, in the United Methodist Church, we practice open communion. That means there's nothing standing between you and this, the Lord's table, except for the barriers you've made for yourself. The Lord invites all who love him, who wish to know him more, to come to the table this day. I invite you to come down as the Spirit leads you down the middle aisle where you'll receive the bread. Today we're going to be doing intinction. We'll take the bread piece and lightly stain it in the cup with the juice. Or you may take a cup from the prayer rail. I invite you to come as the Lord leads you. Pastor, you want to come forward? Oh. Body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you.
us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery which you've given yourself up for us. Lord, let us leave from here prepared and filled with hope, ready to share that hope with others. In your name we pray. Amen. I invite you to rise your able in body and spirit for hymn number 196, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. We'll be doing it from a different tune found in your hymnal. We'll be singing it to the tune of Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Friends, I pray you go from here and have a restful Sabbath. Until we see each other again, I invite you to receive this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you. I pray for you this, that God may give you peace. Amen. Lead the way.
Thank you.